Please note these are a form of social commentary. Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals of any political or gender identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh shit! I'm Pickle Rick! Motherfucker!
You are now watching Useless Geek episode STS.
Because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in old times. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted a written imprint of boot on the face of history since the beginning of time.
Dog will hunt.
Fuck, suck, and eat butt.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
All right, how's it going, my party people? Alrighty, today is the 5th of February. Yesterday we did some shit on, Black History. We did stuff on a lot of different point of views. And we started doing this thing now where we're going to start advertising just before we go on air. That the show is on, because we get a lot of people on TikTok saying, you know, well, we don't get any notifications. We don't get told that the show's on, so we watch it on YouTube. So just to prove that that's bullshit, I'm just going to keep putting these little, like, you know, previously on kind of shit, or, you know, go over to Twitch and watch the damn show so I don't have to hear the complaining. But yeah, let's see if the numbers change at all. I doubt they will. But again, don't do this for numbers. Do this for truth. Now, that leads us to our first segue. Now, let's murder these bitches on the Trumpers and the Truthers. So this is our segue into it. Now, we've talked before about this. I've mentioned this a few times, and it seems to fall on deaf ears. But again, the average Trumper considers themselves to be also a truther. Now, my problem with that is, just like everything else within this MAGA crowd and within this MAGA world, they want everything both ways. It's the epitome and the perfect example, a living example at least, of it's a ridiculous example of having your cake and eating it too. And I had a math teacher that said, I hate that phrase, so I've been saying it his way. You can have your cake and eat it too. You cannot eat your cake and have it too. So that is the proper way of saying it. And I think he said it originally was that, and then it got misconstrued and discombobulated over time, which I believe, because that happens in English language all the time. Look at the word dude or the word fag and look at the evolution of these words. Two very different words, one being positive, one being negative. But both of them have taken all sorts of different avenues. And so that's like, you know, having it one way or the other. And again, with these words, you can have it both ways. A fag can be a cigarette, or a fag can be a person that constantly corrects your grammar on a social media site. A fag can also be a loud-ass motorcycle driver, according to South Park. And it's also known as a bundle of sticks. And like I said, a cigarette in Britain. So they really need to let go of that shit. Just let the word be the word, all right? Obviously, it's not going to go away. And so dude originally was meant for horses and stuff like that, and then it turned into kind of like a insult, and then now it's almost an affirmation, you know? When you say, like, you know, instead of saying, wow, isn't that cool, you just go, dude. You know, like, there's just different ways. My point is, these are the times you can have it both ways. But with these fuckers, you just can't. Okay? So I want to show you a recent clip of Trump actually admitting that he wanted the price of gas to raise. He wanted to raise the gas prices with his Saudi Arabian buddies. And again, this is what drives me fucking nuts, is the Saudi Arabian connection with 9/11 is completely discarded, and in the case of Donald Trump. Like, as if, oh yeah, we think they're the jihadists that killed our country, but they're also the great people that help our president. That don't fucking add up. You cannot have it both ways. So, if you don't believe me, here's a goddamn clip of the motherfucker saying it himself. And this is, I would say it's hard to watch, but I mean, I don't expect any better from this piece of shit. You know, he's made his point very clear that he hates us. He hates our country. He hates our freedoms, and he wants to own them. There's a difference between hating freedoms and wanting to own those freedoms. So listen to what he actually says about the gas companies were all going bust. So what did we do? We fucked over the customers.
I said, this is the first time I've ever said we got to get it up a little bit. I actually called Russia and the King of Saudi Arabia. We had a three-way call and we cut back on the oil because it was so incredible, helped fill up the strategic national reserves, and he's now taken all of that to reduce gasoline prices for cars just prior to the election.
Now, right there, see?
Very artificially. And he's reduced it down to the lowest level that it's been in, I think, 60 years.
So right there, he just told you that he does not like low gas prices. He wanted them to stay high, so that way, who benefits is the one you should be looking at. So going back into the whole truther thing, how can you be a truther and follow a guy that has benefited from the very tragedy? Now, we did a lot of talk yesterday about it, on all the similarities, all the, all that shit. And, the big thing here is the Saudi Arabian connection. Like, it's not avoidable in any way, shape, or form. So, since we're also doing, I try to answer your questions and stuff like that. So, I am going to take 1 second to go ahead, and we're going to check the Twitter to make sure you guys didn't have any questions or anything I can help you guys with. Some people honestly think that, you know, the show is just a way of fighting other people. Badger Mom, oil is a globally traded commodity, and what he just did was admitted to a crime. That is absolutely true. Totally 100% agree with you. I actually put this up recently on TikTok, and it seems to have definitely gotten some love here. What's funny is I just posted this about 10 minutes ago, and I'm trying to show you all of these are just for the same thing, just for that post. USA, stiffing America. Now, I made a joke about SA. He loves SA because we all know he loves the S letter because, you know, he learned how to spell us with the US. So I said his favorite letter is definitely S. So my guess is SA because the guy absolutely loves sexual assault, sexual abuse, and Saudi fucking Arabia. So getting this is really cool, seeing that. So that's why when he was president, gas was a dollar. And when Biden got hit in office, it hit record prices. Oh, okay. See, this person doesn't understand fluctuation and doesn't understand price inflation or supply and demand, price hiking. And he believes that even though he just watched, you know, literally just watched it, a very tape with the man saying that he raised the gas prices on purpose. And he goes on to say that's why it was only $1.80 when he was president. Wow. You know, there was also COVID. We weren't allowed to go out. We weren't allowed, you know, like, let's completely ignore all the shit that happened. So, yeah, let's reply to this bastard right here. You are actually being, I don't know how to say this, so let me just say, you're actually being watched right now on my stream and laughing at your statement. For you don't seem to factor in any of the issues like COVID and the fact we couldn't leave our houses. Of course, gas is going to be cheaper. So, you know, it's just hilarious that these people will go to such lengths to make these horrible points. And the fact that we can't go out made gas cheaper. I mean, there's multiple reasons. So I just want to let them know you're actually being watched right now on my stream. And we laughing at your response. I should just write, we're laughing at your response. You know, whenever you factor in, whenever you're factoring in prices, you always have to factor in all sorts of different things, whether it be the economy, whether it be anything like that. Oh, you know, and that's also funny that he says that, you know, that this guy even says that, and let's also tell him, by the way, it was never $1.80, period.
It was so incredible, helped fill up the strategic national reserves, and he's now taking all of that to reduce gasoline prices for cars just for
the election. This is hilarious. I love fucking with these people.
And there you have it, people. He's literally bitching about lower gas prices.
I'm sorry about that. It's so rude. All right, so we're going on multiple fucking sites, not talking mad shit, but trying to get through to some people because these people do not make sense. Now, again, I just posted this shit. We've been talking for 10 minutes on that. I was trying to look for any questions that people might have. What's it called? Don't act like he has a point. He just rambles, you know? All right. right, so fuck it. All right, so last time we had different questions on, do you think that Biden is going to stop World War III? You know, these are the types of questions that we're getting, and it seems to me like the average Trumper thinks that they are somehow a they think that, like, just because you're rooting for Biden, that you think that Biden is also a god. No, that's just you motherfuckers, okay? When a president is crying, bitching, and moaning about immunity when, you know, 46 other presidents didn't ask for it, never needed it, except for Nixon, and he didn't even have the balls to ask for it. Now, when they talk about the Republican Party and where it's gone and how horrible it's gone, they love to bring up the Reagan administration, saying, you know, well, if Reagan was here, first off, if Reagan was here, he would shill anything that got him money. Okay? Be fucking real about it. He was no savior. He was no man of the goddamn people. He was a shill like everybody else. He would do a dentine commercial one day and then a cigarette commercial the next day. He would shill for any product he could find. Anyone that would pay Ronald Reagan to be in a commercial, he would be in that commercial. Now, if you watch the movie Back to the Future, and he tells him Ronald Reagan is president, and Christopher Lloyd responds with Ronald Reagan, the actor? That was actually inaccurate, because people in the 50s didn't even know who Ronald Reagan was. They knew his face, and the average person didn't know that. And Doc Brown, being the character he was, probably didn't even own a TV, so he shouldn't know who the fuck Ronald Reagan was. They did that, I understand, for plot. It was just to register a plot point. But don't get it confused. You know, I used to love saying "don't get it twisted," but Alina Habba's killed it. You know, as she killed her own career. Shut up. So anyway, let's go back to the Trumpers and Truthers area. Now, again, I've pointed out that, you know, Trump only trusts Deutsche Bank. Deutsche Bank sat there with pieces of human beings on top of their roof in New York. And now he's actually going on and telling people that he thinks he can win New York or New Jersey. I've actually heard him try to say that he thinks he can win in Chicago as well. And I remember laughing so hard at that, because, like, you do realize we spit on your building. Yeah, I mean, it's not your building, you know, it's just got your name on it. But whenever we pass by these things, whenever we, you know, whenever we're stuck having a look at that eyesore, you know, the building itself is beautiful, but the very fact that it has that horrible name on it is the reason why homeless dudes will immediately take a dump right on the side of it. You know, it's a beautiful building. Looks like it belongs somewhere like in India. If you've seen the Indian architecture, they have this love for the single point. And, you know, architecture in its entirety as an art form was basically invented by, or not invented, but really popularized by the Japanese. The Japanese cultures knew more about structure by eye. They would make perfect circles without ever needing a circumference, without ever needing any kind of fucking protractor to make a perfect triangle, you know? These guys did everything by eye. And so when you look at Japanese architecture, it's some of the most gorgeous things you've ever seen in your life. And I feel like that's a dead art form. So going back to that building, yeah, it's a gorgeous building. I absolutely love it. It's a great addition to the city skyline. Get that fucking name off of it, you know? That's our problem with it. We actually love the building. I go in there all the time to take a whiz. It's got a nice bathroom. You know, in Chicago, if you dress reasonably well, obviously don't wear your weed hoodie. But if I'm walking around downtown and I know I'm going to be downtown, I dress for downtown. So I can walk into places like Trump Tower and just go straight to the bathroom. You know, I can literally make up a floor and tell them that's where I'm headed. Just get right over there. I'm the same guy that went to go see Blink-182 last year for free. So if you go down the right alleys in Chicago, Illinois, you can find anything. We are Sin City. All right, so let's keep going. All right, now, a lot of people thought that Trump's campaign was going to be on 9/11 in 2016. People had hopes that this piece of shit was actually going to give us some answers. Instead, he just gave us, you know, he did the same thing everybody else did. Nothing. On the plus side, he never killed any of the survivors. Obama, I'm looking at you, bro. I think it was one of the Jersey girls. It might have been one of the Jersey girls, but it was one of the loved ones of a victim. Had gone over to talk to him, and I guess she had brought over. I really hope she made copies, and you know, I hope she didn't bring any really important like key files that there are no copies to. But she had gone to Obama when he was in the Oval Office and tried to get some answers out of him as Obama ran on a platform to say that, you know, he too has questions. And then, of course, just ignored it right afterward. It's always just some little fucking bait for us to fucking reach for. And in this case, you have a guy like Trump who says, you know, oh yeah, I want to know the answers to this. I want to know the answers to this. But when it came to Obama, he got a interview with this woman, sent her home on a plane, and her plane crashes. It's like V for Vendetta, you know, V said it pretty damn well, you know. I, like God, do not believe in coincidences. Now, of course, there are little ones, but so let's go in further at this interview. At just the sheer delusional process that Trump is going through by thinking that he could win cities like New Jersey or New York. You're not even allowed to do business in New York. You really think you're going to be allowed to be president?
Of issues here, watch what happens.
Oh, I would say maybe it's going to be more than that, because we're going to have, look, I want China to do great. I do. And I like President Xi a lot. He was a very...
Let's remember for a fact that Trump has some of the most obvious tells in the world. I mean, in the fucking galaxy. His tells are some of the most obvious fucking things. I have a brother-in-law who used to have the worst tells at poker because his redness would go up by whatever he had. If he was lying, his ears turned red. If he was bluffing, his ears turned red. If he had good cards, his face would turn red. So Trump, being a non-poker player, a non-athlete, a non-anything, the man's never shot a basketball. The man's never hit a baseball. I've literally only seen him do two things, golf and tennis. And you know damn well he probably played tennis for about 4 minutes, because tennis is one of the most tiring fucking sports you can play if you're playing it right. you're constantly running from one side of the square to the other because you're trying to make sure that you can deflect, reflect, and get that ball to go the other way. So, you know damn well he wasn't playing no tennis. And when we got to see his big old diapers and his huggies popping out of his fucking tennis shorts, it also shows who you are as a person, that you couldn't just wear some sweats and, you know, some shorts and a t-shirt and go out there and play like the rest of us. No. You got to have the matching shirt, the matching pants, because to him, it's not a sport. It's a personality. It's a persona. It's not a game. It's a view. Yeah, it's not a challenge. It's a status. You understand? He does not care about anything but status. So he's the type of guy that'll show up to a tennis game dressed like a professional with the stupid headband and shit and be the worst player out there. It's the common trope that you see on television. The guy with the t-shirts and jeans will beat the shit out of you. Why? Because he's actually played before and he knows that those fucking outfits have nothing to do with your performance. Now, if you're gonna do that, it reminds me a lot of redcoats. Now, back in the Revolutionary War, some guys would take up to 3.5 hours just to get out of their tent because they had to put on the wig. They had to put on all those buttons. They had to put on all these sachets or whatever the fuck you want to call it, sashes and shit. You know, you should look like a soldier, not a duvet cover, you fucking weirdos. And so that's why y'all lost a war. That's why we beat your ass, because we did it dirty. We didn't give a fuck if we were wearing the right color wigs and shit. And that's also, we don't wear wigs in the fucking courtroom. Canada still wears wigs in the courtroom. To me, I find that just ridiculous, and it's just stupid. It's holding on to a pointless piece of history, you know. Similar to the problem with cameras in the courtroom, the only reason why we've ever had people like stenographers and artists in the first place was because we didn't have cameras. Now we do. So all trials should be recorded. We should be able to see how certain testimonies went. How did they do? Do we all believe it? Or was this jury bought? It's not a conspiracy theory because, I mean, shit, everything the government says is a conspiracy theory. 9/11 itself is a conspiracy theory. A conspiracy is one or more people, I'm sorry, more than one person, so two or more people, talking about committing a crime. So if you and your boy are putting your money together to buy some weed, that's a conspiracy right there, back when weed was illegal. So the very idea that you're going to say that 9/11 was not a conspiracy theory, well, then what is it? Because you don't have any answers. All you have are conspiracy theories. You've said that it went to all these 19 hijackers. We found out about 80% of them were still alive and well in Saudi Arabia. We know that you never asked fucking Mohammed bin Salam a damn thing, because he would never tell you the goddamn truth in the fucking first place. We know that Mohammed bin Salam owns Jared Kushner. And so when it comes down to 9/11, you know, when it came down to the court cases from people, really important people, from Willie Rodriguez to April Gallup, they couldn't get seen to a real fucking judge. The judge that they ended up receiving was another fucking family member of George W. Bush. That is some bad luck right there. Not only is that bad luck, but that shows you the tentacles and how far out that those tentacles actually reach to commit whatever acts or covert acts they need to. They have the right people in the right places. Now, Steve Bannon was recently caught saying this on a British network thinking that we wouldn't see it. And he made it clear that, oh, well, we didn't get fascism purely out of the fact that we didn't have enough people. You know, now we've bought them all. Now we actually bought people. So this time we have more people in the executive branches and in all the appropriate branches to get our fascist ideals past the American people. That is what they're talking about. That is not republicanism. Republicanism believes in smaller government and states' rights, something that Trump has been constantly attempting to take away. Therefore, you are no American. Now, let's listen to, again, his delusional thinking in a believing he has a shot to flip fucking blue cities that are very, very blue cities.
And I like President Xi a lot. He was a very good friend of mine during my term.
Well, look, COVID.
Keep saying that shit.
So, talking about, this is supposed to be propaganda for you, man.
There we go.
You can't even follow the propaganda. Right, you're
playing the goddamn
so
video, Ben.
Issues. Here, watch what happens.
Oh, I would say maybe it's going to be more than that because we're going to have, look, I want China to do great. I do.
That's what I mean. When he pauses, he's lying.
And I like President Xi a lot. He was a very good friend of mine during my term.
Well, look, COVID cover up.
When his hands go into the middle, that's also the levels of his lies. So when he stays in the center, that's usually him telling the truth. And then when he reaches outward, that means it's literally his brain trying to reach out and grasp at some straws.
Because we're going to look, I want China to do great. I do. And I like President Xi a lot. He was a very good friend of mine during my term.
Well, look, COVID cover-up, intellectual property
when
theft.
When COVID came,
the list is
different.
Long from our number on adversaries. So
sure.
I don't know if he's a friend.
But I got along with him great. I'm not sure he loved what I was doing because I was, you know, getting along with him.
I don't think he wants you in the White House, Mr.
No,
President.
No, he doesn't.
Now, how she's really, I mean, this is Maria Bartiromo. She's a bought and paid for Trumpian. But even she has the balls to tell him what he's saying makes no sense. To try and go and say, I hate all these, or, you know, I'm against this, you know, XYZ, and yet my biggest influences are XYZ. What the fuck? No, that's not how it works. You know? To say that, you know, oh, A, B, and C are bad, well, then you should have a D, E, F for your own that says, no, I prefer D, E, F, not A, B, C. And in this case, A, B, C is D, E, F. And it's hilarious because he can't help himself but brag about his own personal relationships with the most powerful people, regardless if they are popular for famous reasons or if they are infamous, that he does not know the difference. He's one of those people that think infamous means more than famous. No, it means famous for a bad reason. And people constantly get this wrong. See why? Because most people will gain their definitions of words based on the context clues in which they hear. So I completely understand that. However, our job as adults is to do the research, find out what those words really mean, and make sure that we are concise and we are as well-spoken as possible to convey our points. You cannot get your point across if you don't know the words in which to use. And yeah, sure, that can sometimes make me a pedantic prick. I understand that completely, and I admit it. But I earned that right to be a pedantic prick. I had to do a lot of research. I had to do a lot of reading. I had to prove a lot of motherfuckers wrong to get to the point that I'm at. When you are in your 30s, like I've said this before, you know, from 0 to 10, are your, you know, learning years, you know, that's your primal years. From 10 to 20 is your curiosity years. That is where your brain starts to ask questions and you start looking for those answers. And then, you know, as you go from 20 to 30, now this is the experimental actions rather than just learning about it. Now you get to actually do shit. And this is your chance for opportunity, success, and failure. Most importantly, failure. And then 30 to 40 is where you start to learn from those failures and apply them. So from 10 to 20, you have your elementary years. From 0 to 10, you have your elementary. From 10 to 20, you have your curiosity. From 20 to 30, you have your experimental. And from 30 to 40, you have your actual wisdom. And then you're applying it. By the time you get to your 60s, this is when you start applying your actual wisdom rather than your personal experiences. So, you know, yeah, let's say that. All right. So there's like, you know, primitive and foundational. I'm really just trying to find the right words for it. So right now I'm 36. And so I'm at the point now where I've made a lot of mistakes and now I'm learning to repay what I owe and take all my experiences and use them for good. And then 40, I don't know. I don't know what comes at that age yet, but I know that at some point wisdom comes in, and wisdom is not gained through reading. Wisdom is not gained through writing. Wisdom is not gained through watching. Wisdom is gained through experience and failure. Just like anything else, repetition, experience, and failure. They're the three most important things to a human being. And this man lacks all three of those things. Oh, that was a pretty decent segue right there. So let's hear that report. Let's hear that little softball one more time. And I think it is just kind of nice that Maria, for once in her life, showed some spine. And you know that as much shit as Trump will talk about Fox News, it's the only people he'll talk to. And that says a lot about who you are when you only talk to one person. That means you really don't like you people hearing what you have to say. It means you talk a lot of shit. If you were in school or you had a friend, that was in your circle, and you smoke weed with this guy, you chill with this dude or girl, whatever, this is one of your people, right? Supposed to be one of your damn people. And they never talk to you. They only talk to that motherfucker over there. Everything is like, you'd immediately say, I don't like that dude. Get him the fuck out of the circle, man. I'm done passing it to him. You know, you ain't going to pass the joint to him. You ain't passing that blunt to him. Get the fuck out of here. That's straight up weird. So here's a case where you're going to the one person that you can go to, and she's not falling for it. So maybe Maria just had enough. Maybe.
Look, I want China to do great. I do. And I like President Xi a lot. He was a very good friend of mine during my term.
Well, look, COVID cover-up, intellectual property
when
theft.
When COVID came,
the list
it was
is
different.
Long from our number on adversary, so
sure.
I don't know if he's a friend.
But I got along with him great. I'm not sure he loved what I was doing because I was, you know, getting along with him.
I don't think he wants you in the White House, Mr.
No,
President.
No, he doesn't. The market almost crashed when I won Iowa and New Hampshire. The market went down tremendously.
The Chinese market? Did he just say the Chinese market went down? Because, I mean, we know that he brags about the, we know that he, in his tiny little brain, he actually believes that the stock market is doing so well in hopes that he's coming back. Wow, you have some weird thoughts in that head of yours, man. I'm trying to find like a different way of putting that. I'm trying to find an analogy or a simile or a metaphor or any kind of way of foreshadowing this or parroting this or even satiring this. You can't. You can't make this shit up. I mean, if you listen to that conversation, we played it three times. He backpedaled every sentence. Every sentence he backpedaled on the last sentence. So we talked about, now I love that they didn't even bother showing the part, but when he tried to go off on a tangent, they normally just let him do it. Now, the average question to Trump is, how do you do it, sir? How do you do it? How do you put on your pants? How do you get those big old balls in those pants? You know, that's the kind of stupid ass questions that they ask him. That's the kind of questions he's prepared to answer. But when you start asking him real questions and then you actually correct him on certain shit, like, oh, you know, I mean, you just try to say you're great, not friends, you're great friends with Xi Jinping. And Maria Bartiromo, maybe she actually is a pro-American. And immediately said, well, I mean, come on, man, coronavirus, cover up, trying to bring up all the shit that they believe China is guilty for. And that, you know, it's kind of an elbow to the shoulder saying, you know, hey, don't go into that territory because he's not cool with us. And so he goes from being great friends to we got along beautifully. So that you're backpedaling again. Backpedal, backpedal, backpedal. I don't know how you go forward backpedaling so much. It's absolute nonsense. It is. It's absolute nonsense. Is it nonsense? That's the word. So that leaves us to our next awesome segue on nonsense. And so here's something I meant to show you guys yesterday, but we have time, so let's do it now. We no longer run on a time schedule. We will go as long as we need to, since this is not television, this is streaming. So we go until we need to. Now, as you can see, we're going to go to Roland Martin here. Now, Roland Martin is great. I don't care what Kanye says about him. Kanye has every right to say all the crazy shit he wants, but Kanye and Donye need to shut the fuck up already. Now, because his show is called Unfiltered, I had to call mine No Filter. And what sucks is I'm a cigarette smoker, so I should have gotten Unfiltered. But, yeah. Let's go ahead and listen to him talking about this is a crazy, crazy, crazy world we live in. The amount of pandering is just at an all-time high, which means an all-time pathetic low for society. And so we literally have a, you know, a person aspiring to be a president. We actually have an up-and-comer so patronizing to the American people. These are beautiful buds, by the way. That America was never a racist country. Now, to say that is a lie. America was founded on racism. America has fought racism throughout its entirety. The very fact that we have a constitution that was supposed to be every man is created equally, not only are you leaving women out, but then you get into the, Well, now what qualifies as a man? This led on all the way 200 years later, 1970s and 60s, where you're seeing black gentlemen walking with signs saying, I am a man. This was not a matter of gender. This wasn't a matter of transgenderism. This wasn't anything like that. You refuse, well, not you, but you probably your daddy, your ancestry, refuse to accept that human being as a man, let alone a human being, but a man. Now, that is not a society where everyone is created equally. That is called elitism. And it is blatant elitism because you are literally saying as long as you are of a Protestant religion and a, you know, this certain specific criteria of whiteness without having to bring in words like German or Aryan, they managed to reword it to basically just anti-Negro. And that was really what they tried calling it. And the fact that when Black History Month was created, I can totally understand why this was seen as nothing but insulting. This was seen as nothing but an insult to the very people that have been doing everything for so long. Black history is American history. Now, when you realize that black people were brought into America by force in about 1619. So that means throughout the entirety of our country, blacks have been with us. Now, they didn't ask to be. Y'all forced them to. And then you're going to call them a minority. You see how this makes absolutely no sense? So the country America was not really founded until 1776. Supposedly, that's what we all like to use that number. Really, 1781 was when we had won the Battle of Yorktown, but I digress. Point is, blacks were a part of us since 1619. Part of the North Americas. So, where in that timeline can you call that a minority? No, that's an entirety. They've been with us, and we still have to refer to the they. You know, it makes no sense, and this is why you have brilliant people like Morgan Freeman saying, I don't want a Black History Month because you cannot condense our history into 29 days of the shortest fucking month of the year and dilute us into a quasi-minority in which you do realize that big old White House of yours, we built that, you know? Not only did blacks build that motherfucker, but you made them make it as white as possible to show that fucking elitism. Now, later on, we started getting more immigrants from the Irish and then Italian, and Italians were enslaved. I mean, every slavery has been around forever, but You are not allowed to say that America was never racist. America was founded on racism, but it was specifically America's brutality towards slavery that made us different from every other country. Now, in Europe, they had, caps. They had certain caps on being a slave. You are a slave till a certain age. And there was a lot of different types of treatment. None of this is good. But again, we were exceptionally brutal, where, and Brazil as well. So once the slave trade had been abolished, Brazil was actually forced breeding. And so the law stated that you are allowed to keep your slaves as long as you don't get any new ones. This is fucking history, people. You're never going to read this, but this is real history. And so this brought on people like Pata Seca. Pata Seca is a great fucking man. He was a great fucking person. And he was basically treated like a stud horse. Now, I've heard these racist pieces of shit tell me, when I tell them about this story, they'll say something like, you know, it sounds like the best job in the world. This man was forced to have sex with as many women as possible. They took extra great care of him. He dressed very well. He was well-spoken. He was well-educated. I want to say he even spoke two languages, but Pata Seca had been transferred, moved around from one plantation to the next plantation in Brazil, basically making him the stud horse of Brazil because he was like 6'6", like 250, pure fucking bred muscle. You know, fucking V cut, you know, dude was shredded, but that should be no reason to fucking kidnap a motherfucker like this. So he ends up having to go on to sleep with other slaves so that way they can now breed these slaves. So if a plantation had paid good money for him, or some slave owner paid good money for him, it got him a chance to stick around. So this man ended up giving birth. The number is very, very high. It's in the fucking, I don't want to be wrong on this. So let's just Google how many children did Pata Seca birth. All right. And I want to say it was in the thousands. Oh, okay. So about 250 kids. This poor guy was forced to have 250 children. Now, again, I've heard some really stupid shit about them. About being told that this must be the best job in the world. There's no fucking humanity to that. And so when Pata Seca would be at one place, he would try to spend as much time there as possible to actually raise those kids. So he had 200 children, 300 children, but spent time with them and taught them, you know, for at least the first 4 years or whatever he could. A lot of his direct descendants, you know, his direct children ended up writers, authors, some of the best thinkers. And he literally was something so special that the, you know, colonial white man needed to have him. And it's like, you know, this ain't NFL, motherfucker, where you just get to actually point out at a black guy and go pay for it. You know, that motherfucker gets to go home eventually. So Podseka should be known by everybody, but he's definitely not. And it's just sad. So my point is that to say that America is not a racist country, granted, that was Brazil. But like I said, he was well-educated. Like they treated him very well. He was not allowed to be marked. He was not allowed to be branded. He was not allowed to be whipped. He was not allowed to be any of this shit. In America, he probably never would have gotten a chance to have 200 kids because America was so disrespectful that they would literally kill children in front of other children to show them how good work is done. They didn't do that in other countries because even they had their own limits. So America has always had this tendency to go too far. And where that comes from, I don't know. I don't have any answers for you. But let's move on and let's listen to Roland talk about this. And we'll talk about Nikki Haley and her comment that America is not a, was not a, ever a racist country. And again, that has to be one of the most glib and false statements I've ever heard.
All right, Republican presidential candidate Nikki Haley went on The Breakfast Club in an air today, and
sorry, that was also my point on pandering that I've never seen before. We're at a point of so much pandering. Nikki Haley is actually going on The Breakfast Club. What in the fuck?
Folks are calling this her longest conversation on race. Host Charlamagne the God and DJ Envy.
More like her longest conversation with a black questions man.
About immigration, racism, and the removal of the Confederate flag. Haley explained how growing up in a rural South Carolina town motivated her presidential run.
I grew up in a small rural town, and we took care of each other. It was neighbors taking care of neighbors.
Just real quick. They always preface it, and when I say they, white politicians that claim not to be racist will always start out, I come from a small little town where everybody took care of each other. Now, could it be that it's a small town because they keep to themselves and keep it one race? Now, let's remember Nikki Haley has a father that's fucking Indian and had to go to a black college because white colleges would not accept him. And then she goes on to destroy the very same loophole that got her father an education and a career to get her to this point to fuck him over. This is Nikki Haley.
And there was just something simple about it. And there was just something that was good. You genuinely wanted to take care of people. Mm-hmm. And we've lost that. I mean, right now you see hatred.
Now, when she says that, it's like, okay, and now what you see? Do you mean you see that in that small town? Or you're saying that you went to the big city and saw all this hate? Because I've never been in a small town. I never lived in a small town. I live in the second fucking city. I live in one of the fucking most violent, crazy cities in America. And I love every bit of it. I knew every neighbor. I knew every motherfucker on that block. We knew every house. We knew who to egg, who not to egg, who to trick-or-treat with, who not to trick-or-treat at, and who gives the right candy. And where that fucking one pervert don't go by his house. We had that. So what are you talking about that this small town mentality is only meant for you little white towns? I'm from Chicago. I'm from Albany Park, bro. And we all knew each other. And everybody did help each other. We survived blackouts like it was nothing. Because blackout meant free party. That means everybody's coming out with their grills. You know, we had a community. You know, and it's not hate that broke it up. It's rich-ass white people that bought all the fucking houses. It's the rich fucking cocksucker that went on and took out the city planner and had our entire block destroyed. That's the fucking problem. It's not that your little small town has got a black guy in it. And this is the shit they won't even say on the Breakfast Club. But, oh, I fucking say it because I'm fucking real. Damn.
You see division? You see anger? I mean, you see these things where they're trying...
Stop.
Thank you.
Oh, my God, please stop.
Thank you.
So let me explain to y'all what happens there. This is the perfect example of the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm.
Long ago, we lived in simpler times. We lived in a time where everybody got along. Things were great.
Now, before he gets to that, let's also remember that those times were actually way more violent than now. The murder rates were higher. The average rape went unreported. The reason why we have so much more anger and shit is because we're better at reporting it and making fucking public records of it. Sorry, just had to throw that out there.
Great. We weren't fighting each other. We weren't mad. We weren't upset. Nikki. Your daddy couldn't get a job because he was Indian.
Mm-hmm.
And was only hired at the HBCU. Your mama. White folks wouldn't buy her dresses.
Yep.
Black women did. But do y'all see how she's trying to play this? Things now, we're so divided.
I completely forgot to add that point in that, you know, her parents are not white. I mean, they were not treated like white people. So this is what I call a fucking turncoat. You know, she went from having a real fucking name to Nikki Haley, sounding like some fucking Karen that's going to ask for the manager. That ain't your fucking name, bitch. Be yourself. And that ain't gonna happen when you're so afraid of the almighty white collar. Because in the end, that's where that dollar comes from.
If you ask most people, they're not fighting with their neighbors.
Thank you.
Tell us what she's talking about. But this is how they try to frame this thing. Oh, the world today is falling apart. If only we could go back to how it used to be. You mean like Jim Crow? I'm good.
Damn straight. If anybody is constant, I mean, when you are constantly telling me that you guys want to roll back the time clock, the clock, y'all want to roll back and go back. I don't want to go back to certain shit. And granted, we all had better lives because, shit, the economy was great. We could buy firecrackers in Chicago all year round. Dollar stores always had good-ass firecrackers. We would fucking play with each other out on the street. We played kick the can with the whole fucking neighborhood. We had video games, too, but it was way more fun to be out there and play some fucking street hockey. Or what the fuck, have a giant game of fucking basketball. That was what it was about. And you're going to constantly say that, oh, things were great. And what happened? Like, we're not fighting with our neighbors. Our hatred is not with any of that shit. It's with your bullshit that keeps having to affect our goddamn lives. That is the only fucking real division there. So it's just, it's fucking sad. Y'all want to keep talking about rewinding the clock and let's go back to this. And I want to, you know, remember George Bush, George H.W. Bush saying, oh, I want a country that looks like the Waltons and not the Simpsons. So you're saying you want a black and white fucking separated life. You hate colors and you hate the fact that we have them. It's not our fault that your dumbass can't get a tan. Okay, it really ain't. The very fact that we have a fossil record that shows that we all came from Africa and then moved and migrated, because we do that. That's what humans are fucking meant for. We are meant to spread and move on to the next place because we need the resources. The planet was ours for the taking. The planet was meant for us. It's a perfect shade of fucking green that we needed to, or and all we needed to survive. And then we came up with industrialism and architecture, like I mentioned with the Japanese, finding a whole new art form and creating the most beautiful fucking things out of architecture. And then that guy ends up having a child that he worked so hard for. And that child, if he's not a part of his father's life and gets to learn about that shit with him, he's going to go off. He's going to go to school to be a doctor or whatever the fuck makes more money than dad. But he's never going to have that same love, that same pride in what he does, because it's a book. It's a piece of paper for him. Where dad relied on what he had. He relied on his wits. And this is Japan I'm talking about. Not no fucking white people. So this shows that we were meant to take this planet together as one and make it our own. Instead, we have divided each other, just as the actual terrain divided through evolution and through gravity and because of the fucking the oceans. So it's like once all this shit separated, it was separating for us to be able to have all this shit. And then, you know, with each area comes different fucking terrain, different fucking herbs, different fucking thing, different reasons to go. There's different resources in each area. So, for instance, primates. Look at, you know, primates. There's certain parts in Asia that have, or in Alaska, there are no monkeys. There are no fucking monkeys or primates in Alaska. Now, it is believed that it is because of the frozen water that is so long, monkeys or apes didn't make a damn raft. Now, although they did use tools, and they still do use tools, they don't build anything but huts, because it's really not in their nature to have to spread out. It's just in their nature to spread on and get more family. So I think if we need to take a step back whatsoever, maybe we should take a step back to Africa. So that way we can learn who the fuck we are again. All right. I love you guys. Stay safe. Stay free. Stay yourselves. I'll see you on the other side. Most of all, stay cheesy, my friends. And we'll be back with another episode tomorrow. Love you guys. Stay cheesy.
Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals of any political or gender identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh, shit! My pickle red! Motherfucker!
You are now watching Useless Geek episode 2. STS.
You want to be sure what you want. Because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in Poland. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted a written imprint of boot on the face of history since the beginning of time. Fuck, suck, and eat butt.
Welcome to the desert of the real world.